I'm just having a coffee in the garden. Oh, have you met the snakes? My pride and joy. Come on, it's just through here.
Okay, well, welcome to BBC online service on April the 26th, 2020. You're really welcome, whether you're a regular or you're just joining us for the duration of lockdown. My name's Steph. I'm a member of the leadership team at BBC, and I'm going to be leading us through the service this morning. Now, for Christians, wherever we are and whatever we do, it's really important to gather together to spend time with God, and that's what makes this time of lockdown particularly difficult, but thank God for technology. Anyway, it's really important that we take time to focus outside ourselves and spend some time with God, who is the maker of the universe and the source of all love and hope. So as we spend time together with God today, we're going to be doing that in a variety of ways. We're going to be singing, we're going to be listening to a Bible story, and we're going to be listening, and Nigel will be explaining more about that particular story that we'll be listening to later, and we're going to be talking to God and with God in a variety of ways. And if you've got children and you're regular at BBC, then you will have already received an email from us with some ideas on how to help your children engage with God at this time. Now, you can do that at whatever time your family suits. There'll be a time later on in the service, and I'll let you know about that, when you can go and do that with your children, or you can wait till a bit later. Got our neighbours in the background there. But I'll be letting you know about that. But if you do make any of the activities, do feel free to share them. We're having virtual coffee after the service. Or you can post what you've done, picture of what you've done on Facebook. But before we do anything else, we're going to spend time talking to God. We're going to spend time praying. And we're going to use the prayer that Phil said last week, and the words are going to be coming up on your screen, and they're going to be read to you. But please feel free to join in reading those words with Naomi and Mary as they just lead us into a time of focusing on God.
Almighty God, who has always existed and always will exist, who rules in all power and authority over all that you have made, we worship you this morning.
Lord Jesus Christ, who lived among us, died for our salvation, rose in triumph over death, and now lives and reigns with the Father in the heavenlies, we worship you this morning.
Holy Spirit, who was poured out upon the church at Pentecost and still lives in your people today, empowering and enabling, transforming us into the likeness of Christ, we worship you this morning.
Holy God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, accept our praise and our worship, we ask, not because of anything in us, but because you look on us in love and mercy. Cleanse us from all that is wrong within us, and adopt us into your family as your children, brothers and sisters of the risen Christ, in whose name we offer our prayers and our worship. Amen.
So we came inside because it was getting a bit noisy outside, all that bird song. Anyway, we're going to move into a time of singing together now. And singing to God for some people might seem a bit weird. And particularly now, even if you're used to doing that, singing to a computer screen is, well, I think anyway, it does feel weird. But music and song has always been important in the Christian tradition for about 2,000 years. And it's a way of us being able to connect with God. And I don't know how we do it, and it's a great mystery, but there is something special about singing and singing to God. And I'm going to hand over to Emily now for this part of our journey. And she's going to lead us in song worship.
In the midst of human uncertainty and difficulty, we look at the world around us and we see the beauty of God's creation. And we remember how powerful and awesome he is. And we're going to start our praise and worship this morning by singing together, O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the works thy hand hath made. The song, How Great Thou Art. Thank you. Wonders whether he is really in control. And at the end of the book, God speaks to Job. He says, "Where were you when I laid the earth's foundation? Tell me if you understand. Who shut up the sea behind doors? Have you ever given orders to the morning or shown the dawn its place? Have you journeyed to the springs of the sea or walked in the recesses of the deep?" And so it goes on for four chapters, as God talks about just a few of the incredible things that he's done. And at the end, all Job can do is stand in awe of his Creator God. Let's sing together. Who can know the mind of our Creator? Thank you. Father, we stand in awe as we consider who you are, the works of your hands. All we can do is stand in awe. We bow down and we worship you. And we ask, Lord, that this morning you, the awesome creator, powerful God, will be amongst us in each of our homes as we worship you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Emily, Naomi and Mary, for that. Now, if you're a regular at Beverley Baptist Church, I just need to give you a bit of information. One, don't forget that there will be virtual coffee at 11:30 after this, where you can come and join and we can see some familiar family faces. You should have been sent a Zoom link to be able to access that. Secondly, do join us at 8 a.m. on Friday mornings to pray together as a community about things going on in our community, about obviously the things that are going on in our world at the moment. Do come and join us. There will be a Zoom link sent out via email every Thursday to invite you to that as well. And thirdly, at Beverley Baptist Church, we like celebrating. And we usually like celebrating with food. So if you've got something to celebrate, whether it's a birthday, anniversary, or something else that's special that happened in the week that's just gone, or in the week that's going to come, let our crunchy angels know, either by the Beverley Baptist office email address or by the Facebook page. Those crunchy angels will get that crunchy to you at some point during the week. Now, I don't know about you, but it's now end of week 5, we're coming into week 6, and the whole lockdown thing has definitely lost its novelty factor for me. Although I do have series 5 of Line of Duty still to watch, just in case, and particularly if the weather changes. But seriously, this is getting quite difficult and challenging, not just for me, but for a lot of us. And for some of us who've been struggling from the start, it's really important for us as a community to be really aware of those people, not just within the Beverley Baptist community, but within our neighbours and our friends and our family. So keep in touch with each other. Be kind if you're living with your family. That's a really important thing, big challenge for me. And ask God to show you who and how you can reach out to people. You can do that, and don't be shy. You can do that by text, video chats. You can do that even by using the good old postal service. Who would think that sending a card through the post has become on trend? But as Christians, we have something else that we can do. We can also stay connected with God. In fact, it's the most important thing that we can do at any times in our lives. God has given us this opportunity to be able to connect with him so that we can hear his perspective on what's happening. We can listen to what he is doing and take part in being the solutions to some of the things that we see around us. He loves it when we talk to him. He loves and really welcomes us sharing our thoughts, our concerns about things. And now there's a passage in the Bible, in the really old part of the Bible, the Old Testament, in 2 Chronicles. And 2 Chronicles 7 verse 13 says, "When I shut up the heavens so that there's no rain, or command the locusts to devour the land, or send pestilence among my people, if my people who are called by my name humble themselves, pray, seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sin and heal their land. Now my eyes will be open and my ears attentive to the prayer that is made in this place. Now some of the language there is a bit old and kind of complicated. Now, I'm not going into that passage, but for me, one of the things when I heard that being read earlier on this week was the importance of us seeking God's face, and also the fact that he will open his eyes and his ears to what we talk to him about. So prayer is a wonderful and powerful gift. Let's never ever underestimate what our God can do. And today we're just going to have a time of prayer. Now we're not going to be closing our eyes and putting our hands together, but we are going to be listening to some of the young people, because this week we're going to focus on the young people in our church community, but also think wider as well about church, young people in our society. So I've asked three of our young people, Grace, Josh G and Gabriel, I've asked their opinions about what they think about lockdown so far, and I've asked them three questions, and those questions are going to be coming up on your screens in a minute, and then following that they're going to be giving their answers.
The worst things about being in lockdown are that you can't socialise with anyone. Also, my grandparents are in Spain and can't come back home very easily. And my auntie and uncle and cousins, who I don't see very often, are in Japan, and they were supposed to come back here for Easter, but now that can't happen. Also, since foundation, I've always wanted to be in Year 6. And now I'm in Year 6, it's awesome, but now we can't do sets, and that's what I've been most excited about all school, really. But that's not happening, neither is Leavers Day, which is a disappointment as well. But the good thing about being in lockdown is that we have learnt new ways to communicate with people. I've been using some of these, like Zoom for church, WhatsApp and messages for texts, and I've been phoning people. I'm also playing online with my cousin. I'm bad at listening to when God's speaking to me, but over these past few weeks in lockdown, I've been thinking about how God's been speaking to me, and I've really thought about how much stuff I've got compared to other people. I've got a lot of possessions, and some people don't even have enough to live on. Also, I've been watching Spring Harvest, which has helped me to think a lot about listening to God as well, and I really enjoy watching all the different channels on Spring Harvest and videos. And also I've been reading devotions every day, and they've been talking about obeying God and your parents and being patient, and I've really taken that in and tried practicing it.
What's the worst thing about being in lockdown?
Not being able to play any sports for school or my clubs, and not being around my friends.
Okay, what's the best thing about being in lockdown?
I get to spend more time with my family, and I have more free time during my breaks because I can watch TV shows or play outside in my garden.
And what has God said to you in this time?
That he is in control of all this, and he wants more people to get closer to him during this time.
Okay, well, what's been the worst thing about lockdown so far? Probably the feeling of not being able to help with the fight against this invisible killer. I think we can also all agree with the general lack of freedom, not being able to come together, see friends, spend time with family, and to even meet up on a Sunday morning has certainly been less than ideal. And then finally, probably the growing sense of uncertainty for everybody's health, the economy and life as we'd previously known it. And the best thing to come out of all this is probably the fantastic opportunity this has given us to reflect on what's important in life. I've been spending a short part of my day every day going for a bike ride, which has really helped to keep a level head and has also given me a newfound perspective on how lucky we are to live where we do. So I've been lucky enough to recently get a hold of what is called a 3D printer, so that I can continue with the work that I'm doing for my postgraduate studies. As you might have heard in the news, people have been using these machines to help make and supply critical PPE equipment for essential workers. As a result of this, I believe God was giving me the overwhelming edge for me to contribute and for me to do my part. Then right here I've got some of the surgical mask ear protectors that I've printed. I'll be dropping these off shortly for the staff working at the Swinemore Community Hospital. Furthermore, if you'd like to find out more, or if either yourself or somebody you know could benefit from one of these devices, then please do get in touch with me and I'd be more than happy to help.
Thank you, Grace, Josh and Gabriel, for answering those questions, for your time, for your honesty. Let's just spend a few moments now praying for the young people in our church community, but also as I pray, just think of those young people in your families, in your neighbourhood. Think of the young people nationally, particularly those who've gone through cancelled GCSEs and A-levels, and who are not sure what to do and are really bewildered about university and what comes next. So let's just take a few moments to pray. Lord, in this time, I pray that you be the person who brings peace. That, Lord, you guard the hearts and minds of those young people that we know. Lord, that you protect their mental health and their physical well-being. Lord, that you meet with them in creative ways. They experience you, Lord, and that you meet with them and that they become the hope bearers for this generation and for our nation and world. Amen. I'm just pray now for our younger members as they go to engage in their activities that I mentioned earlier. Lord, that you meet with them as they make and play. Amen. And I'm just going to move somewhere a bit more comfortable for the next bit of the service too. Right, I'm going to read a story for you in a minute. And then after that, Nigel's going to be explaining more about what that story can tell us and what we can learn from it today. And then we're going to move into a final song. But the story I'm about to read is a bit of a weird one. Mind you, I think if you read the Bible, there's quite a few weird stories in there. But this story is set on Easter Sunday in the afternoon. So it's after Mary and some of the other women have gone to the tomb and found it empty. And Jesus starts appearing to his disciples in lots of strange ways from that point on. And this is one of the first accounts of Jesus appearing to some of his disciples. Now, I'm going to be reading from the Passion Translation, but the words that you'll see on your screen will be from the New International Version. Sometimes I think it's helpful to listen or read different versions and translations because it gives us a fuller and richer picture of what some of the points or some of the important aspects of what we can learn when we're reading it. So I'm going to be reading Luke 24, verse 13 to 35. Later that Sunday, two of Jesus' disciples were walking from Jerusalem to Emmaus, and that was a journey of about 17 miles. They were in the midst of a discussion about all the events of the last few days when Jesus walked up and accompanied them on their journey. They were unaware that it was Jesus walking alongside them, for God had prevented them from recognising him. Jesus said to them, "You seem to be in deep discussion about something. What are you talking about? You're so sad and gloomy." And they stopped. And the one named Cleopas answered, "Haven't you heard? Are you the only one in Jerusalem unaware of the things that have happened over the past few days?" Jesus asked, "What things?" "The things about Jesus, the man from Nazareth," they replied. "He was a mighty prophet of God who performed miracles and wonders, and his words were powerful, and he had great favour with God and the people. But 3 days ago, the high priest and the rulers of the people sentenced him to death, and they had him crucified. We all had hoped that he was the one who would redeem and rescue Israel. Early this morning, some of the women informed us of something amazing. They said they went to the tomb and found it empty. They claimed that two angels appeared and told them that Jesus was now alive. Some of us went to see for ourselves and found the tomb exactly like the women said, but no one has seen him." And Jesus said to them, "Why are you so thick-headed? Why do you find it so hard to believe every word the prophets have spoken? Wasn't it necessary for Christ, the Messiah, to experience all these sufferings and then afterwards to enter into glory?" Then he carefully unveiled to them the revelation of himself throughout the scripture. He started from the beginning and explained the writings of Moses and all the prophets, showing how they wrote of him and revealed the truth about himself. As they approached the village, Jesus walked on ahead, telling them he was going to some distant place. But they urged him to remain there and pleaded, "Stay with us. It'll be dark soon." So Jesus went with them into the village. Joining them at the supper table, he took bread, blessed it, broke it, and gave it to them. And all at once their eyes were opened and they realised it was Jesus. And then suddenly, in a flash, Jesus vanished before their eyes. Stunned, they looked at one another and said, "Why didn't we recognise it was him? Didn't our hearts burn with flames of holy passion while he walked beside us? He unveiled for us such profound revelation from the scriptures." They left at once and hurried back to Jerusalem to tell the other disciples. When they found the 11 and the other disciples all together, they overheard them saying, "It's really true. The Lord has risen from the dead. He even appeared to Peter." Then the two disciples told the others what had happened to them on the road to Emmaus and how Jesus had unveiled himself as he broke bread with them.
Well, good morning. I trust that you're getting used to this new normal way of being church. But I have to confess that for me, it's anything but normal. And so to help me, I have in front of me a screenshot of the Zoom after church meeting from last Sunday. And it helps to remind me of the many and varied situations that we're finding ourselves in during this strange period of lockdown. And I can also see that at the moment, at least, you all seem to be awake, which is great. Well, today is the second in our series of life-changing encounters with the risen Jesus. It's the walk to Emmaus, entitled An Eye-Opening Journey. So it was Easter Sunday afternoon, and two disciples, Cleopas and possibly Mrs. Cleopas, we're not told, were walking down from Jerusalem to their home in the little village of Emmaus, about 7 miles away, roughly the distance from Beverley to Cottingham. And as they were walking, they were talking about all that had been happening in Jerusalem over the recent days. And they were sad about the death of Jesus, that cruel crucifixion 2 days before. And they were disappointed and disillusioned that it seemed, after all, he was not the promised Messiah that they had hoped for. And they were also perplexed because that very morning there were reports of the tomb where he had been laid as being empty and the body being missing. And so it was that for some reason they decided to leave Jerusalem and go back to their home. We don't know why, but it seems symbolic that they were leaving the scene of all the activity and going home. It seems to be seems symbolic of their abandonment of any hope that they had had. Jesus' death had proved to them clearly that, after all, he was not the promised king that they had been expecting and hoping for. And then Jesus joined them, and but they didn't recognize him. It seems like he had chosen to keep his identity from them. Of course, it's not unusual for somebody to join a group of people walking, although not these days, of course, in our days of social distancing. But it would be not unusual for people to join together for company or for protection. And they fell into conversation. And why was it that they didn't recognize him? Well, the reading suggests that in part it was Jesus choosing deliberately not to reveal his identity. But I think it's compounded by the fact that they were in such an emotional state and such a state of being unprepared for any possible meeting with him, which was compounded by their lack of understanding of all that he had taught about the fact that he was going to die and rise again, and also their lack of understanding, as we shall find out shortly, their lack of understanding of their own Bible. These were all reasons why they didn't recognize him. And so as they walked along, the stranger could see that they were sad, and he asked them what they were talking about. And they were rather sharp in their response. Are you not aware of what's been happening these last few days in Jerusalem? Are you the only one? Where have you been all this time? Which is a bit ironic when you think about it. And so it was that they poured out their hearts to him and explained how they'd been followers of Jesus of Nazareth, who was absolutely, clearly, beyond shadow of a doubt, a prophet come from God because of his teaching, which was revolutionary. He taught them to pray for their enemies and love them. He spoke about an abundant life that he would give them. And he had tough teaching about judgment and sinners who don't repent. And he backed up his teaching, and his teaching was of great authority. He backed it up with what he did by way of miracles. He had great compassion on the poor and the sick, and he healed them. He was able to calm the wind and the waves when the storms rose out on the lake. And he even fed 5,000 people from a mere 5 loaves of bread and 2 fishes on one occasion. He spoke of God as his father, not in any arrogant way or self-promoting way, but he spoke with authority. And all this led us to believe beyond any doubt, really, that he was the Messiah who had been promised. And then the climax was when he came into Jerusalem riding on a donkey about a week ago, and we hailed him as the king who had come to redeem Israel. But now all that seems to have just vanished, because our religious leaders have put him to death last Friday, 2 days ago. And all our hopes are dashed. That seems that he wasn't the promised Messiah. And can you understand why we're sad and disillusioned. And all this, of course, is compounded by the fact that of these reports of the empty tomb, the mystery disappearance of his body. And of course, in answer, Jesus would have said, yes, I do understand. And it's his nature to draw near to us, even when we can't see him and don't see him. It's his nature to let us know that he understands our doubts, our sadnesses, our disillusion. In Hebrews, we read that our high priest is somebody who sympathizes with our weaknesses. And in Isaiah, we're told that God was distressed in all their distress. One of the commentators, David Gooding, puts it rather nicely when he says that it was kind of the Lord, who had entered Jerusalem as king, to travel back with two of his disciples down the road of their disillusionment and listen to all the reasons why they now doubted whether he was after all king. He travelled down their road of disillusion. And then there was a bit of a shock, because this stranger said, well, surely, don't you believe, don't you understand that this is exactly what was supposed to happen? If you knew your Bibles, you wouldn't be perplexed. You wouldn't be down and dejected. And Jesus began, or the stranger to them, began a rather lengthy Bible study. At least they had 2.5 hours, which was about the time it would have taken them to walk to Emmaus. And his Bible study took them through the whole of the Old Testament, where he was able to point out to them their misconceptions about what the Messiah was going to do and be. Sure, the Messiah was going to eventually become a triumphant king, but the path to that was through his death and suffering. His death wasn't just an obstacle that he had to overcome, but it was actually the central part of the plan. Jesus would have taken them to those passages in Isaiah that we are rather familiar with. He was pierced for our sins. Our punishment was upon him. But these are passages which it seems that these disciples had either overlooked or had not believed or had neglected. And so, by the end of their Bible study, they reached the village of Emmaus, and Jesus made to go on with his journey. But they asked him if he would stay. They said, it's because it's night time, and surely you don't want to go travelling on. But there may well have been other reasons. In fact, they had been warmed in their hearts as they'd heard him explaining their Old Testament to them. There was something about this chap that made them want him to stay with them. And he had actually helped to open their eyes, at least of their understanding about what had happened, in a fresh way. So it's no wonder that they wanted him to stay. And he graciously accepted their invitation. And they went in and they sat down very, very soon for a meal. And then something a little bit strange happened. Jesus, who was the guest, broke the bread. Normally the host would have done this, but we don't understand, not told why. But Jesus broke the bread. And at that very moment, we are told, their eyes were opened and they realized it was actually Jesus who had been with them all along. And then he disappeared. That is all so strange. How would they have actually recognized him? Well, they would have probably seen, as he broke the bread, that they would have seen the nail prints in his hands. But our reading tells us that it was actually in the act of breaking bread, principally, that he was revealed to them and they recognized him. Maybe it was because it reminded them of the previous occasion when he broke bread at the Passover meal that he shared with his disciples just a few days before. They weren't there, but they would have heard of it, and the way he broke bread and blessed it and explained that this was his body, which was going to be broken for them. Maybe it reminded them of the way he blessed and broke bread the five loaves with which he then proceeded to feed 5,000. So for one reason or another, they recognized him as he broke bread and then disappeared. But we're not told of their immediate reaction to all this, but we can guess. There must have been a mixture of obviously surprise and joy, because their friend and master, who they had thought had died, was actually alive. And this accompanied their new understanding that they had already gained from his Bible exposition. And of course, there probably would have been some fresh perplexity at the fact that he had suddenly disappeared. What were they to make of it? Let's just pause for a moment and reflect before we finish the story of what all this might mean for us. I think it's fair to say that there's probably not one of us who wouldn't be eager to have a renewed and a fresh revelation of Jesus. Every one of us is unique. Our situation is not the same as these disciples, with their particular sadness and disillusion. But each of us has our own reasons and ways in which we may be at times unable to see him as he really is. It may be disillusion or disappointment or false expectations or sadness through bereavement, or we may have relationship problems or just simply preoccupation with life's ordinary pressures, or especially those of these uncertain times. Any or all of us can be tempted to move away from God and find ourselves unable to see him and all he is doing, just like these two who chose to leave Jerusalem, which was where it was all happening at that time, but they chose to leave and go back to their homes. But the fact is that whatever our situation, he knows and understands and will always draw near to us. And there are three things we could just notice about that accompanied the way in which these disciples had their eyes opened, which we could apply to ourselves. Before their physical eyes were opened, Jesus had already opened the eyes of their understanding and warmed their hearts through the Bible study that he gave them. And then secondly, there was the invitation that they gave to him to come in and join them. It reminds me of the letter to the church at Laodicea in Revelation chapter 3, where Jesus stands at the door and knocks and says that if anybody will open the door, I will come in and eat. And, you know, I'm sure the picture of Jesus standing at the door of Holman Hunt, where there's no handle on the outside. So it is important for those on the inside, for us to open the door and let him in. He will never force his way on us. And then finally, the revelation of Jesus in the breaking of bread is significant. Eating denotes fellowship and relationship and the intimacy of family. And for us in particular, as we gather together to break bread from time to time, it's an important way in which we can experience the closeness and the presence of Jesus as we are reminded of his death for us, his broken body, but also the fact that he is the bread of life, which he gives us and shares with us. And then what are we to make of his sudden disappearance after he revealed himself to these disciples? It seems that perhaps he was getting them used to this idea of the new normal. Yes, he rose from the dead, and he wanted to prove that by showing them his physical body and eating with them. But before long, their relationship would be one of faith rather than sight, just as it is for us. This also comes up in the encounter with Thomas, which Emily will be speaking about next week, I believe. Jesus says, blessed are you who have seen me, but blessed are those who have not seen and have yet believed. So how does Luke end the story? Well, Jesus had disappeared, and in their joy and their surprise, what were they to do? Well, they decided they would pack up and immediately go back to Jerusalem to let the others know. And that's quite significant, really, because it denotes a going back to Jerusalem that they had left in sadness and disillusion, but in this case, going back with joy and their hopes renewed and restored. And I'm sure that they would be dying to pass the news on to their fellow disciples. And it was significant because this was another return journey of 2.5 hours, and this time at night. Not the sort of thing you did in those days because of the dangers. But they wanted to go back to tell the rest of the disciples. Not only had they seen him with their eyes, and he'd revealed himself to them in the breaking of bread, he couldn't have been an imposter, because nobody could have done that apart from Jesus himself. Not only that, but they had to share that how Jesus had explained to them, that it all made sense. This was breaking news. So I'm sure that they would have shared not just that they had seen him alive, but their new and fresh understanding of what it all was all about, that his death was not a unhappy accident, but it was all part of God's plan. And God's plan was so much greater than anything they could have understood or imagined. Jesus certainly was king, but in a very different way from what they had imagined. Jesus was king, and his kingdom was very different from what they had imagined. So let's conclude with a few thoughts. Let's rejoice that he is alive, but let's also rejoice that his ways and his purposes are so much greater than anything we can understand and imagine. Let's remember that whenever we are sad or disillusioned, he understands and will always draw near. And our only job is to keep the door open, especially if we've been closing it and perhaps are getting lukewarm, as the folk in Laodicea were. That passage in Revelation, knocking at the door, was to Christians who had been getting lukewarm. Let's remember that there's no substitute for spending time with Jesus in his word. He will feed our minds, as he did to these disciples as they walked on the road. He will feed our minds and our spirit, and he will warm our hearts as we experience his presence. And of course, there is no substitute for our fellowship together, you folk, and especially as we meet, even if we meet virtually in these days, to break bread together and remind ourselves of our Lord, our Saviour, our friend who gave his life for us and is now alive, and whose life we draw on. Amen.
As we reflect on what God has been saying to us through Nigel this morning, we're going to sing two songs to close our time of worship together. We're going to start by singing Open Our Eyes, Lord, which includes the line, Open Our Ears, Lord, and Help Us to Listen. And then we're going to go straight from that to ask that Jesus will be the centre of all that we do. So let's sing together.
Jesus.
Thanks, Nigel and Emily, for that. So we're going to finish soon, but if there's anything that you want to contact somebody over, then please do email us on contactus@beverleybaptist.com, and that's all one word, .com, or you can leave a message on the answer machine on 01482 863811. Oh, I almost forgot, didn't I? I said at the beginning that I'd set a challenge, but I've got to keep the age limit down. It's only for people who are 11 and under. Right, so the challenge is, as you walk through the door, you might have seen various words and symbols to do with love and peace and joy and hope. So I'd like you to count how much love, hope, joy and peace that you spotted around the room from when you came through the door to when I sat down in the back garden. So let me just repeat, like you to count all the love, joy, peace and hope that you spotted as you walked through the house and as I sat down. And the first one to get the correct number of all of that and to send it to me at stephanieph.tongeman@gmail.com. The first one to send the correct answer will get a prize winging its way to you somehow during the course of this week. Oh, and I just want to give you a little bit of clue. Some of the love might come in the sign of love, in the form of love hearts. Just a little bit quick tip there. So we're going to close now. And as we do close, we are going to say the grace together. And it's the words that you can find in Corinthians. And they're going to come up on the screen. So do feel free to join in with me as we say, may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.